our final race of the weekend. It's hard to believe we're already at the final race of the weekend, but we are. And there's our pole sitter car we're looking at, the white Elva Mark VI prototype of 1960. That's Joe Bojalin from Swickley. Car number 70 on pole by the best qualifying time about 5 seconds or so over the car you see sitting right behind it. That's Andrew Barron's yellow Lotus 7 car, about 70. So on our live stream, we're looking at the first two cars sitting on the vault grid. Starting third will be car 88, Chris Livengood of Pittsburgh, in a Formula car. First of our vintage Formula Vee is car 88, a Lynx. Starting fourth is car 37, George Bapa. Just talked to Stefan Bapa. Here's George Bapa coming up from Delaware, racing his 97. Starting fifth car, number 87, Roger Bailey of McMurray, Pennsylvania, in his 1972 Lynx Formula
Vee. That's why.
Starting sixth, car 22, Christian Morisi from Holston, New Jersey, in the Lotus 22. Car number 22, starting sixth. Starting seventh is car number 773, the Formula Junior Lotus 18 of David Allison from Dunn, North Carolina. Starting eighth, car 97, Oliver Shiliano from Allison Park,
and he won
in a Formula V in 1972 Lynx. Starting ninth, car 7, Christopher Morisi from Clifton, New Jersey, in a 1958 Lotus 7. Starting 10th, car 77, Alan Patterson III of Pittsburgh, his Elva Mark III. Starting 11th, car number 4, Stephen Morisi from Brightwood, California, in a 1963 Cooper Formula Junior. Starting 12th, car 160, Ivan Long from Millington, New Jersey, in a 1960 Zinc Formula Junior. This might be a Formula V. We'll check on that. Many of the things that we see are Formula V, maybe all of them. Starting 13th, car 72, Christopher Patterson of Pittsburgh in Elva Mark IV. Starting 14th, car 122, Leo Basile of Arthurdale, West Virginia, in a 1965 Cooper Formula 3. Starting 15th, car 667, Victor Pastore from Chester, New Jersey, in a Gemini Formula Junior. And let's see, 16th on the grid, 971, Daniel Hellman from Huffman, Texas, in 1959 Cooper Formula 1. We'll wait and see. I believe it's a Formula 3. There's our field leaving the fault grid. Rolling out again. Generally, this is the fastest race of the weekend, the fastest cars on the Sunday Park course. These are dedicated race cars, either Formula cars or sports racers. Most of the other cars we've seen all through the weekend of racing have been modified production cars. These are all the cars that were designed and built especially for racing. And our race is brought to you by Ford, final race of this Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix weekend, 33rd annual PVGP at Schenley Park. Race for group number 6. It's actually the 7th race of the weekend. Our race brought to you by Ford. And again, you're hearing it on the PA system here at Schenley Park. The PA system is running on FM radio at 88.7. If you have access to the internet, you can watch live streaming at streamingpittsburgh.com or via, I think, the PVGP website. You'll find information about that in the program. I certainly hope that you can pick up or already have a program for the 33rd running of the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix. It's full of lots of background information, previous race winners, lap records, maps of the course, articles about interesting cars and drivers, and so on. It's a wonderful buy at just $5. And let's see. And then there's an app that you can get for mobile devices that follows racing. And that carries our race results and also the audio of our race coverage. So again, pace lap is underway for race number 6. Thank you. it's been a fabulous race weekend. We've been surprised because in the last couple of months, the Pittsburgh area has been rained on every other day, it seems. And there was expectation and forecast for rain this weekend. And we have made it all the way through the weekend so far with one race to go with not a drop. And the sun is shining right now, so we're in good shape for this event this year. It's started out back in 1983 as a one-day event on Labor Day, 1983, and has grown to be a 10-day event with a rally, countryside tours, car shows, a black tie, two race weekends, one at the Pittsburgh International Race Complex, newly expanded. We inaugurated the new long course last weekend in Beaver County, Pennsylvania, and of course this weekend in Shenley Park, in between car shows in various neighborhoods in Pittsburgh, and other events all around the city. So it's become just about the biggest event in Pittsburgh every year when you combine all the events that make up the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix over 10 days of activities. A lot of people work very hard, a lot of volunteers, I should say, work very hard to make everything involved in the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix happen to benefit the Allegheny Valley School and the Autism Society of Pittsburgh. And I hope that if you're interested in participating in this event, it's nice to be a spectator. It's more fun to be involved in the event, and we invite you to join us if you'd like to do so. Here's our pace car pulling in, and we're looking for our race field. There they are. That's the white sports racer of Joe Bojalid on the pole. And we have a start. And we are underway with Joe Bojalid jumping into the lead, as it has been the practice on practically every race this weekend. The pole sitter gets the jump into the first turn. Andrew Barron starting second. And car 37, George Vapa, currently shown in third place. So Chris Livengood, who started third, crosses the finish line in fourth place, so a little bit of position changes even before they cross the starting line. So there's some question about car 122. We're taking a look at it. Leo Basile with the Cooper Formula 3 car. Not sure what the corner workers are looking at or for, but they're keeping it under observation at the moment. Well, I think this was may have been the largest Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix in the Spotlight car, 80 to 100 Thunderbirds here. We saw many of them on parade during our opening ceremonies earlier today. Just a fantastic thing. The Janis Joplin Porsche was on display in the Porsche Club area this weekend. Special guest, Satch Carlson, noted motoring journalist, was here on behalf of the BMW Club and their display. So special things throughout the park this weekend has made this a very special 33rd Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix. Here's our leader, Joe Bojalid, in the white Elva sports racer. Andrew Barron in car 57, the Lotus 7, and I have to say it didn't sound healthy to me when it went by. It didn't sound quite right to me. I'm not sure. Something funny about, know whether the engine is missing or maybe he's broken an exhaust header. So we'll see if he's able to continue and hold on to second place. Andrew Barron in car 57. Of Chris Livengood has slipped just a little bit. He started in third. He crossed the start line in fourth, and scoring is now showing him in fifth place in car 88. That's the Lynx Formula V, car 88. Chris Livengood of Pittsburgh. So we're getting lap times around 2 minutes 20 seconds, quickest laps of the weekend, I believe. Well, actually, time not far off the over 2 minutes. Laps, perhaps in the upper 18 to 19 from the leader so far in this race, car number 70, Joe Bojelad. These are 8-lap races, final race of this weekend. Thanks for sticking it out. And I often find that behind us here at Race Control, we often have a large group of folks viewing, particularly over by the pit entrance over here. And late in the day on Sunday afternoon, things are a little quieter. It's a little emptier than usual. Well, it does make a long weekend as we're approaching 5 o'clock. I don't know how well you can hear the cars, but I'll tell you that just compare the sound of the two Lotus 7s that are running second and third. They sound completely different. Andrew Barron's car and George Vapa's car, they look the same. They're both Lotus 7s, but they sound very different, and I suspect that Andrew Barron's engine might have a problem, but he's still in second place. Understand that Chris Livengood, car 88, maybe this is why he's fallen back to fifth, perhaps came in contact with another car, and that the nose of that car has come off. That's the Lynx Formula V, car 88. And the nose is off the car and off the track as well. But the car is still circulating as far as we know. Always do want to make sure that if things fall off the car, they go off the often a thankless job. A piece of a car part that might have fallen off. The car that just went out of view here on our cameras is a relatively rare type of car here this year. We used to get more of the front engine formula cars. That's car 667, Victor Pastore from Chester, New Jersey. It's a 1959 Gemini Formula Junior, and a rare, for us, Formula Junior car that's front engine. It's 1959, it's right at the transition point between the front engine era and the mid-engine formula era, just when Lotus was changing over and Gemini hadn't quite done so. So it's interesting to, we get accustomed to the look of the mid-engine cars, and then you see a car like Victor's Gemini, and it looks peculiar because the driver is sitting so far back in the car, so close to the rear axle. Yes, Chris Livengood indeed is circulating without a nose cone on his car, but he's up to third. There was some question whether he might pull in the pits and put on another nose cone, but that would take him out of contention. So as far as we know, he is going to continue, or at least he thought he was going to continue. Now we get word that they may actually give him, they could be giving him a black flag or a meatball. We're not sure why he would get a black flag unless he came in contact with another car. There is a suspicion that that may have happened. That may be why Chris Livengood lost the nose. Perhaps his car came in contact with another one. Three laps out of eight. Waiting for the field to come along. It's a 2.33-mile road racing circuit if they're circulating at about 2 minutes, 20 seconds a lap. Sometimes there are these long gaps between cars. There are a little bit of... if you look at the video, you won't necessarily notice that there is a good bit of elevation change in the track. They come down quite a hill. And they come down from the last turns around 17, 18, 19 from the Serpentine up by the golf course, and they squiggle down here to our level at start-finish. It's quite a change in altitude. Well, there's our leader passing that front-engine Formula car. And we mentioned a moment ago, Victor Pastore's 1959 Gemini. So he's just been lapped by our leader. The two Lotus 7s of Andrew Barron and George Vapa are still second and third. Oliver Sciogliano is fourth in the Lynx Formula V car 97. Okay, 88, car 88. Chris Livengood, the car that was circulating without a nose cone, now we understand is... has pulled off course, perhaps after contact with another car. We do know that he is off. Let you know where they are. It's car 88 and car 87. Is it 87 or 37? Not sure. I'll pass that along in just a moment. Is Chris Livengood's Formula V, both off at station 14, and both will get a rope tow in at the end of the race. Station 14 is up there along the Bob O'Connor golf course at Chumley Park. They found a pretty safe place to pull off the track into the grass. So talking about elevation changes, and you can see this on the track map that's included in the program, the Panther Hollow Bridge is the lowest level of the racetrack, down at 920 feet above sea level. The highest point is at the top of the Serpentine. That's about 1,060 feet. So that's, 140 feet elevation in a half lap. So they may not notice that they're going uphill from the Panther Hollow Bridge. Well, you do really notice it when you head up into the golf course. And then, of course, coming down through the Serpentine, there's quite a descent in a very short length of track. Working lap six out of eight. Our leader is on lap six. The yellow car 77, that's Alan Patterson, the third of Pittsburgh, the 1958 Elva Mark III sports racer. C So again, we have five laps complete. Not much of a road incident. On any race weekend, you can depend on a couple of cars having minor mechanical problems, and we had some yesterday with a broken spindle on one car, a head gasket on another. We did have a car that was pretty seriously damaged when it came in contact with a jersey barrier yesterday. No one hurt. The car came away, Porsche, not in very good shape, I'm afraid, but for the most part, I think that's pretty much the only real damage done to a race car this weekend, so we've been very lucky. Some mechanical problems, of course, cars being towed in after their races, but very clean racing here at Schenley Park this weekend. Here's our leader to complete lap six. Joe Bujolad right there heading into turn one. And a new second place. And I guessed it would happen at some point. Christopher Morisi gets his Lotus 7 past George Vapa's Lotus 7 to take second place in car number 7 on this, the beginning of lap 7. So second, third, and fourth cars in this race are all Lotus 7s. Just looking at car 122 that just went by us. The Formula 3 Cooper of Leo Basile from Arthurdale, West Virginia. It looks like it's going quite well, but the engine is he's running 8th at the moment, Leo Basile. Car 122. That's Ivan Long. You're watching right now go through turn one in the Formula V. A Zinc, 1960 Zinc Formula V. Is that our oldest Formula V in this race? It may well be. Noose is going out there for the driver of car 70, so one lap to go. And it looks possible to me that Christopher Morisi in second place could actually catch our leader. I thought initially in the early parts of this race Joe Bujolad had quite a commanding lead, and I thought he was just going to run away with the race. Well, Christopher Morisi has been quietly making his way closer and closer. This past lap he was a second and a half behind Bujolad and just set the fast lap of the race, a 2:19.8. So I'll go out on a limb here and predict that Christopher Morisi will be having a very tight battle with Joe Bujolad for the win. I think he's going to make an extra effort this lap. Thank you. had a Formula car go by. I think that was Leo Basile, who had his hand up, which is generally a signal, I'm going to pull in the pits. This is a car that has a misfire. And he approached the pit entrance and then changed his mind, apparently, and continued. I thought at first, well, the misfire has cleared up, but it hadn't. He just decided to do one more lap. I think probably he made that decision when he saw that there was just one more lap in this race. I see the checkered flag is now in the starter's hands, so there's our race winner, Joe Bojalad, and I was wrong because Christopher Morisi is nowhere in sight. And I think that he had some kind of an incident. In fact, I am seeing that he had an incident. He went off the track and hit a light pole, right? Down the street from us, you just saw a video here on our stream, and I think took the top off a light pole. And we have a red flag. Red flag, that's a stop the race. So there's concern that because the top of the light pole fell to the ground, there are now live wires hanging right down the road from us. And we can to get another view of that. I think we saw just a moment ago a shot of the car sitting by the light pole. The car pulled away and drove into the pit. But right there you see almost in the center of the screen the top of one of the light poles snapped off when the car hit the pole. And surprisingly, it's a Lotus 7. They look very spindly, but the car didn't look damaged at all when he drove by. Not exactly sure how that happened. No one hurt, but there is concern that we see wires dangling there from the light pole. So someone will be writing a check, I guess, if you win the car event this weekend. But, you know, if you were going to plan to have an incident like that, could you plan it any better than on the last lap of the last race of the weekend? So they were given a red flag, and that tells the drivers to stop wherever you are on the track. When you see a red flag, you pull over, slow down, pull over, and stop there. And then we'll give you instructions as to when you can continue. And sometimes if there's a real problem up ahead, like a blocked course, we might even instruct the drivers to turn around and come back to the pit in the opposite direction. I don't think they have to do that this time because there's no obstruction on the track, but we'll have to bring our field in slowly and on the other side of the track. The car 7, Christopher Morisi has pulled off at station 2, so he went just a little bit by us. So he is our second place car, is that right? That's he has scored. It's funny, our scoring system is showing 7 laps complete, but I believe our leaders finished their 8th lap. I think we had the checkered flag flown at the 8th lap, so I'm not sure why our timing is not up to date, but I don't believe Christopher Morisi, shown in second place, actually did finish there. He had an incident just before the checkered flag. And if I'm correct in that, George Vapa has finished second in car 37, and perhaps Andrew Barron in third in car 57. But we'll wait to collect details. Well, it makes an exciting way to conclude this 33rd annual Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix here at Schenley Park. So the race control folks just down the table from me here are dealing with this situation, trying to figure out what we do next when we have wires dangling from a light pole. But we do have both police and fire on the premises if we need it. We don't at the moment, but they are here.
Alan, what's going on over there?
And I just want to say, once again, thanks for joining us on this weekend. And I once again also invite you to join with us. We want to ensure many of us have been involved in the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix for many years. And so it's always important to get new blood, new people joining us to keep it going and help it to grow. And if you'd like to become involved in the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix, we would love to have you, really. It takes a lot of volunteers and a lot of work and a lot of time, and it's a lot of fun. So if you'd like to do that, you can go to the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix website, pvgp.org, to find out about volunteer opportunities. There is, in fact, a whole section of the website, very well done, I must say, to encourage new volunteers to tell you how you can get involved, what kinds of jobs you can do in the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix. And we'll be in touch with you, and we'll bring you along. That would be great. I did want to say thanks to the volunteer firemen who came this weekend and joined us from North Belle Vernon and from Smithton. Luckily, we haven't really required their services, but we can't run a race without having people ready at standby just in case we need them. So thanks to North Belle Vernon and the Smithton volunteer fire folks for coming. Yeah, the top, the pole, the light pole that we were talking about, and we saw the images on screen, but if you weren't watching the video stream, the car apparently hit the base of the light pole with enough force that it didn't push the light pole over at all, but it jarred the pole and the top snapped off and fell to the ground. And of course, the top of the pole is what holds the wires. So the top of the pole fell to the ground and the wires broke that were attached. So we threw the red flag that stopped the cars on course, and we are in fact going to send the cars around counter race. That is in the opposite race direction. That's what having the red flag enables us to do. There are no cars coming in a race direction. We're going to send all the cars that are still on course back in the opposite direction. This is the end of the last race of the weekend, and so we'll bring our cars in. And I expect that we will work around this issue and bring you our victory lane celebration shortly. We'll take a break, get back to you when we're ready to do our podium celebration.
Wouldn't be shaky if I knew you were on it.
I got one of your photo ones. Well, I'm going to have a discussion with Graham because he's the one that caused the red flag. And I do. But I know you're going back to line.
I got one of the corner workers.
Third.
Well, I'm going to have a discussion with Graham because he's the one that caused the red flag. We just figured that out. And I beat him to the finish. I know you're going back a lap. Yeah, that's okay. I'll trade with him.
Guys,
you guys can
just slide out of the way. We
can figure that out.
The whole ceremony the time you do?
Mm-hmm. Okay. It's the last one.
I just didn't know if you couldn't get a car here or not.
You and I need to trade because you're the one that calls the red flag.
Where's the damage?
And you had a spark. The spark flew off up here.
That guy, I came on the inside of him and he brake checked in the corner and the car just completely disappeared when I came off the brake. I went around third like, I ended up.
Your girlfriend's flipping her freaking noodle. I'm like, he's fine.
It took me about 40 minutes
to
figure out.
The top of the pole came down and brake behind your car. I was shooting Joey getting the checker flag. And the top you hit, and it, you know, I guess the pole's old. It snapped the top pole off. It came right down behind your car.
No way!
I got scared for a minute. That's a crazy.
It looks like the bees were there with you too.
Yeah, but the guys ended up.
The only person, you were chasing the white car. He was in first. What do you mean, how did you get second?
Yeah, but I didn't cross the finish line.
I didn't see him come back around.
The race. You pulled a
Roger's yellow.
Nico Rosberg at Monaco.
Living good.
The white one. They go to the lap before because nobody crossed checkers.
You didn't put my name on my number on the board right at the end, did you?
No, I didn't. Yeah. Ask Christian. I wouldn't even mention the number. No, I wouldn't even mention the number. I wouldn't even watch.
Did. Yeah, they went to the last lap.
They went back a lap.
We need to trade.
That's not his to give away. And you was like,
yeah,
you got me too.
Dude, you got down to it.
You were a lot faster.
Oh, I bet mine.
There we go.
All right, we'll have to go talk.
So here's your winner pulling into pit lane. He's going to come up here for the victory celebration. Counter race that is in opposite direction to the race direction. And what happens when you can't complete a race, and in fact, because the incident occurred just after the checkered flag was flown,
you were catching him
cars because the rest of the field couldn't
I didn't realize he was that close.
They roll it back to the end of lap 6. So the official finishing order is the order as of the end of lap 7. And the leader at the end of lap 7 is
Wait a second, I was going so slow.
I know you were.
I didn't, and then he said, second place car is the one behind you. I said, sure. Yeah? Then I had to do, I did like a 217 or 218, but I mean.
Yeah, we noticed.
Yeah, I mean, you know what? I can't hear anything unless I'm on the, unless you're on the front straight or right up here. I can't hear you.
Yeah, well, with all this. Yeah. You're not supposed to have radio.
I was glad to see you.
Oh,
okay.
Take care. I gotta go.
Yay!
Thanks,
least I kissed my baby.
Yes, you do.
An exciting race. You didn't see probably the biggest excitement in this race. It happened behind you.
No, I heard when I came around, I saw a couple red flags. I pulled over after the bridge, and they said somebody hit a pole, a wire came down, but I guess it was up here, and I must have missed it.
It was right. It happened right behind you. It was the way we scripted it, you know, last lap or the last race of the weekend, it came out perfect.
I'll tell you who the live wire was, is the guy in the Lotus, because I thought I had a pretty substantial lead, so I was, you know, peeling off slow laps, and thank God Joe told me. He said, the guy behind you is the guy in second.
Yeah.
So,
well, we were saying that you had had, early in the race, a huge lead, and I thought he's going to run away with this race, and suddenly somebody was catching you.
Well, we've got the cars had a lot of issues, and Joe Servin with Group 5 has done a phenomenal job. So we've been putting Band-Aids on it all year, and we want to just get it through the year. So having a lot of trouble with the motor, but you know, the setup's great, and the car's hanging in there.
The car looked fabulous. We didn't see any problem with you or the car this weekend. Yeah. Congratulations.
I think I'm the problem. The car, yeah.
That was a great win.
Thanks so much, Ted.
Congratulations, Joe. Second place, where's Christopher? Christopher Morisi.
I'm actually Graham Long. What?
I never know who these guys are. They're never who they're supposed to be. Graham.
Yeah.
Well, you, I guess you're the live wire this weekend.
Yeah, it was pretty hot out there.
It was a heck of a race, and we were really having fun watching you because for a while there, I thought the car sounded funny, you know, and but the car ran apparently really well.
Yeah, the car was absolutely phenomenal. It's pretty much spot on.
So great race, and I really thought that you were going to be able to give Joe a real run for the money. In fact, you were closing on it.
Yeah, you know, about three laps to go, the car got really greasy. The tires were overheated, and the car was sliding around a lot. And coming out of turns, it was very difficult to keep traction. So anytime I would catch up on him in turns, he would just out-accelerate me out of them.
So how about the driver? Overheated as well?
Oh, yeah. It's a little brutal driving these conditions.
Now tell us what happened over here. I understand that I didn't see wires come down, but I understand there was some sparking on your car as you sat there.
Not on the car, but off to the side of me, I saw something. Yes, yeah, so that's why I pulled out of there. The car was still running, and I just drove away from it.
Well, you are very lucky that the car doesn't look hurt much, and you don't look hurt at all. And congratulations to you in a very fine second place.
Thanks so much. Appreciate it.
And George. Well, it was really fun in this race because this very streamlined, sleek-looking sports racer is out front. And then these Lotus 7s, these...
old ones. 1959.
So fast, and apparently good handling cars, and maybe really well-suited to this this circuit.
Yeah, very much so. They weigh about 875 pounds and 115 horsepower or so they're a lot of fun.
Well, it looks like a fun race, and congratulations! It was a well-driven race.
Yeah, thank you. I'm gonna have to have some discussion with Graham because they moved the scoring back to the next to the last lap because of the red flag. Yep. But I actually finished in front of him, so I think we need to change matters.
I thought so too, and I you'll have to work that out.
We'll work that out.
Okay. Congratulations. Thanks for coming this year. And the Worker Award goes to a driver of car number 4, and that's another Morisi, Steve Morisi. I have to say that, as you know, the Morisis have been supporting our event since year number 1. And it seems the racing family grows. Every year, more and more of the Morisis are driving, and congratulations on getting the Worker Award.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. I'm really shocked, to tell you the truth. But I appreciate the workers. We couldn't do this without you guys. And I appreciate you seeing how good I was driving, apparently. It was great.
Well, I'm glad you came this year. Thanks so much. It's a beautiful car. Anything special about this car?
This was my father's car. And in 2007, I became the owner of the car. And It's got a lot of great history with my dad, has a lot of great history with me, and back in England. So it's a fantastic car. I love driving it.
Well, the Maurices have a special connection with Lotus, I think. Do you ever drive anything else?
Here's the thing that a lot of people don't know. It's a Cooper, but it's powered by Lotus.
A Cooper Lotus.
It's a Cooper Lotus. It's got a Lotus engine in it.
Well, congratulations. Thanks again for helping us put on the 33rd Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix.
Well, thank you. Thanks you for having us. It's a real honor.
That's great. Wow. Hot. Yeah, my dad just came 1 year. I got the race with him.
I can't do anything about people stepping on my table. Can we
get one?
The white one
now.
Past me.
Before I get out of the town.
Come on, guys. Get up here.
Jacob's not here.
Where's Jacob at?
He went for a while.
Just call me an hour before you're returning. Because we're in and out of the office.
Wait, you got to go.
No,
how was the trip?
Yeah, 1-5.
Five.
How'd everything go? Excellent. Okay, thank you.
Wait, he was looking. You were walking.
I was looking right there.
I came here yesterday and nobody was around but him.
And he was like talking, you know, like,
okay.
He did. Just like, you know, like, getting another shoe.
Where's your big brother?
Yeah.
I didn't think we were going to make it over that thing.
That must be where the wire went down.
You gotta walk all the way down.
And
I was actually looking.
Who knows how long? And who knows how long
it'll last? Somebody's gonna catch up.
You know how to get over there? Okay, well, let's go.
I looked in my mirror after I went past the Mark IV, and I saw you go
around.
Yeah.
Okay, winner in the middle, second place in this thing.
Yeah.
Pardon me, we got the press here.
I tell you what's weird is coming back the other way in hay bales.
Oh, you can all grab a boot?
Yeah, because they maybe
make sure the logo is facing this way. Right here, please, big smile.
Okay, I'll take the glasses off.
The real Marici got up there.
What kind of bumper?
Which one?
Coming out. See you next
time. All right, good job, guys.
Good job, guys. Thank you.
I'm talking about the bag.
They kept calling him Chris Marici. You care?
Oh, no.
He did the same thing last year.
Yeah. Coming over when you're ready. You ready? I'm ready when you are.
Well, once again, the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix comes to an end. It's been 33 years now at Schenley Park in Pittsburgh, raising funds for the Allegheny Valley School and the Autism Society of Pittsburgh. It's been a fabulous race weekend. The weather predictions were iffy. The weather turned out to be fabulous. The racing was great. The crowds were bigger, and the car shows better than ever. So thanks for joining us during the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix. It's presented by the Greater Pittsburgh Automobile Dealers Foundation. And as always, the Pittsburgh Vintage Grand Prix benefits the Allegheny Valley School and the Autism Society of Pittsburgh. So on behalf of all of us at the BVGP, thanks for joining us. Please come back next year for number 34 in 2016.